And welcome to the Aberdeen Wings Coaches Show. Joining us now, Coach Anzalone from the Aberdeen Wings. Thanks for taking some time.
Thank you very much, Ward. Happy to be here.
Hey, Coach, you know, the Thanksgiving weekend, we were busy. We had three games over that entire weekend. And, you know, it was kind of rough, but, you know, give us a little insight. You know, how was that? Three games in 1 week. And, you know, the players, they've got so much going on during the Thanksgiving week, of course. And so does everybody, all their billet families and everybody in the organization. You know, tell us about the week all together.
Yeah, well, we were disappointed with how the week went from a result standpoint. Obviously, going 0-2-1 last week at home is very, very disappointing to all of us, players, staff, etc. I thought last week the name of the game for us in the games, I thought it was very much an at-times and in-part type of a week for us. We played well at times in the three games, and when we played well, we were often playing well in part. We never quite had every guy on every line going. I didn't think we generated enough of our scoring chances, though we generated some nice ones. We didn't generate enough chances as a group, as a line of three forwards and 2D. There were a lot of one-on-twos and one-on-three type chances in the games against Minot and Austin. There were a lot of chances where we would go in like one-on-oh, one player on the goalie, or we'd make a nice move cutting in wide, but we didn't quite have a guy going to the net. There were moments in the games where we were really good as a team. So that's what I mean when I say we were playing well in parts and at times, the parts, not the whole. And that for me was the difference in at least two of those three games for sure.
You know, I noticed Friday night, it looked like we had three, four scoring opportunities right there in that first 3 or 4 minutes of the game. But, you know, that game altogether, you know, they see a 3-0 win. They had an empty netter win. Empty netter in that game as well, but tell us about the play of maybe not so much the goaltenders, but our defense altogether or special teams.
I thought our defensemen played okay this weekend. They're getting better, they're improving, they're developing each weekend and each week in practice. We have one returning defenseman on the blue line right now. The rest of them are all first-year players, so they're growing, they're maturing. This is a hard league for defensemen. The great thing about the North American Hockey League is it's very below the circles oriented, mm-hmm. So you've got to be really good in the tight areas of the rink, and if you're a defenseman and you want to get involved offensively in this league, you got to be willing to get up the rink and join the rush and activate in the offensive zone and pinch and become a factor that way. So I think our defensemen are coming along nicely. I think we also just have to acknowledge the fact that there's a lot of first-year D on this team, and not everybody steps in and makes an impact right away. So it's a work in progress for sure.
You know, we talked off camera about some things that happened over the weekend, and one of those was, of course, a fight out on the ice. And Coach, what's your stance on that and how the rules have evolved, especially for this season alone?
Well, there's not a whole lot of fighting in the game and in junior hockey with USA Hockey's new stance that in the first altercation, it's 5 minutes for fighting and a 10-minute misconduct on top of that. And I still believe fighting has a place in the game. And I think the Drew Doyon-Alex Peterson fight is a classic example of a good old-fashioned hockey fight that happened at the right time in the game. And it happened for the right reasons. And I don't get involved with what goes on in the players' heads. And I as a coach, have never told a player, now's the time, or have tapped a guy on the shoulder, anything like that. I don't feel that's my place. I thought that Drew and Peterson dropped the gloves at a moment in the game where we needed some momentum, we needed some life, and Peterson and Doyon wanted to go. It was a very clean fight. It was punch for punch. The linesman got involved when both players hit the ice. And both players skated away and had mutual respect for each other. So for me, if there's such a thing as a hockey fight, that was it. And I don't think there are too many people out there that would argue with that type of a fight. I think in those type of scenarios, it still has its place in the game. And I give credit to both participants for handling it like men.
You bet. And, we did get a question in from our fans, and this comes from Mark. And Mark asked the question, why do the Wings, or teams altogether, dump and chase the puck so much, especially on the power plays, and are they lacking the confidence to skate that puck in?
Well, this is actually a really good question, and it gives me a chance to talk about a hockey topic. First of all, any coach, any team, any player would rather carry the puck in under control and have the puck on his stick, because when you have the puck on your stick, you are on offense, the other team is on defense. There's no question about it. It's black and it's white. But the fact of the matter is, it's hard to play with the puck on your stick all game long, especially in a league like the North American Hockey League, where the defensemen play their gaps very tight. Like, if you look at Austin, they are a very tight, aggressive gapping team. When the gap is tight, that means that the ice isn't necessarily available in front, but rather behind the defenseman. So a great way to get an advantage on the opponent is to put the puck in behind the defenseman, have him turn, and have him go back for it. Now, before you can reestablish possession, when you put the puck in the other team's end zone, you've got to place it properly. And this is an area we are working on constantly each week. You've got to get placement before you can get possession on your forecheck. And to do that, you've got to put the puck in a soft area of the zone. And that's the corner or right along the boards where the wall starts to become flat. The area you don't want to put the puck when you place it in is near the goalie, because if he can handle it, especially behind the net, your forecheck is ruined and you're going to have a really, really hard time getting the puck back. The worst thing to do when the goalie touches the puck or the puck goes behind the net is chase behind, because now you're coming up the rear as the defenseman starts to step out with the puck. So there's a lot of reasons why teams will put the puck in. And another reason why is there are some coaches out there that believe, and I subscribe to this, I wouldn't say it's a core belief of mine, but I acknowledge it, that it's very easy for defensemen to defend when they're watching you and they can see the play coming at you. But when a defenseman has to look over his shoulder and go back for a puck, and he can hear an aggressive forward coming, that's harder for a D, because he's constantly turning all night. He's constantly checking over his shoulder, and he's got a guy pursuing him. So there are a lot of different reasons why. On the power play, a lot of times it's done for tactical reasons, to get the puck back. It's called a hard around or a rim. So I could go on for about 45 minutes here and bore you and the listeners to death. We want to carry it in as much as we can, but the fact of the matter is there are some situations when we just can't, and we've got to put the puck to a good area so we can get it back. And Mark, that's something we're working on this week.
All right, Coach, well, coming out this weekend, you know, we always talk that every team in this division, especially in the NHL Central, there is no placements. But last week, taking on number one Minot and number two Austin. This week, we take on 4 and 5 Bismarck and Brookings. Coach, what do we look forward to? What do we anticipate? What do we work on for this weekend?
Well, this is a really important weekend for us. This month, we play the same two teams the entire month. So we'll be going at it with Brookings and with Bismarck pretty good. I think it will be a really competitive game on Friday night. Bismarck's coming off of a well-earned split with the Minnesota Wilderness. They won an overtime or a shootout, I believe, on Saturday night. They're pretty high. We're pretty hungry. We've had a good week of practice so far. We're trying to do more as a team. We're trying to skate more for each other in practice. We're trying to get open and be available for each other more, and it starts in practice. So we've had a good week so far. I think we're going to be pretty revved up and ready to go on Friday night. It gives us a chance to put these three rough games behind us, and these should be two tough games against two real tough teams. Again, I wouldn't read into who's in first or who's in second, third, fourth, or fifth. This is a tough division, and I'm confident in saying that whoever comes out of this thing at the end of it all is going to be real battle-tested and hungry.
You bet. Coming up this Saturday, we're at home against the Brookings Blizzard here inside the ODI Center. You can find more details on the game, including some promotions and things going on. And there, the special jersey auction, the silent auction, which is on our website at AberdeenWings.com. You can go and place your bid on some extra jerseys that we have from the Aberdeen Area Humane Society special jersey auction. You can find those on our website at AberdeenWings.com. Other than that, you can find game times and promotions and things like that, rosters, schedules, updates, and a whole lot more. Follow us on Facebook and Twitter, and we'll talk to you next week for the Aberdeen Wings Coaches Show. Coach, thanks for coming.
Okay, thank you very much.